عالمها وأن نحشر في الآخرة مع أهلها من الصادقين. ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا رسول الله، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على رحمتك للعالمين، مسك الختام لسائر الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، صلاة وسلاما تامين دائمين باقيين إلى يوم الدين. ونسأل الله أن يحشرنا معه وألا يحرمنا شربة من يده الشريفة لنظمأ بعدها أبدا. ثم ما بعد، brothers and sisters, I really appreciate the invitation of my beloved Imam here and the hospitality of this community, and I am really thrilled to spend this time talking about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it seems like with these days, in these days in particular, talking about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becoming not only important but quite critical, simply because it seems like people from different background, people came from Far East, Middle East, came from Africa or Latin America, it seems like it's an obvious concern. People are concerned about their status in terms of belief. People are so worried about their spouse. People are worried about their kids. Are we going to be able to raise our kids properly or not? It seems like teenagers are going through their own struggle, and there is a culture gap between some of our kids and their parents. We have this struggle between is it proper to adopt the American culture or not? Which one is important to implement the culture we grew up with in any country we came from? It's actually important to practice the message of Islam. What's Islam after all? Is Islam to wear a specific kind of dress, to speak a specific language, and to be a member of a specific community? Or Islam is more than this? Which one of us is more Muslim than the other? Am I going to be a better Muslim by the way I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or am I going to be more Muslim by being very strict? Better Muslim by being very strict with everyone. So in this regard, the smiling is forbidden, and you cannot be easy in your life. Are you going to be a better Muslim by studying, spending long time learning and teaching and trying so hard to have so much information in your heart? Are you going to be better Muslim by memorizing the Quran al-Kareem? Can you be a good Muslim and a good American in the same time or not? Are we going to be able to face, frankly, the challenge we are all facing as people live as minority in the West? Talking about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Prophet, can be an obvious answer to all of that. Simply because while people are opening a huge debate about being conservative or liberal, being in the far right or left, while people recite the Quran al-Kareem and sometimes they have their own understanding, we can answer all of the questions by saying, let us look to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and try to be like him. It's very simple. You don't then have to be a very great scholar to be a very good Muslim, and you don't have to spend your entire time in the masajid. And let me give a few examples. Scholars from different areas of the world, the Muslim scholars, all agree that what we call the Sahaba, the most special people around the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we call the Sahaba, so many of them spend a very short time with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you go through Sira and you understand that Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, for example, one of the great companions, he spent a few days, not even 1 week, with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he left to his own tribe, Bani Ghifar. It seems like it can be quite shocking when we realize that someone with the name Sa'd ibn Mu'az, the one the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about him when he passed away, the throne of Ar-Rahman, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, become shaken in the time of his death. Sa'd ibn Mu'az was not a 90 years old man. Sa'd ibn Mu'az passed away in his 30s. And sometime we have to make this connection to remind ourselves. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud or Abdullah ibn Abbas or Abdullah ibn Umar, we stereotype them all by assuming that they were very old people with a very gray hair, and they didn't know what, they had tough time talking because of their age. They were very young. So the names we often repeat, we have to put it in its context. When we talk about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are talking about the role model for all of us. So if you want to be the perfect husband, you have to start reading a little bit about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how it's old. For you to find out that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a member of his family, was not really a scary man. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to compete with his wives. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to help them cooking and cleaning the house. And I am not making this up. When they ask Sayyida Aisha about Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith sahih, قالت كان رسول الله في مهنة أهله. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كان في مهنة أهله, means he used to do whatever we are doing in the house. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ولما قالوا لها, when they said to Sayyida Aisha, صفيهِ لنا, صفيهِ لنا, they asked her to describe to them الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. Sayyida Aisha said, لقد كان رجلا من رجالكم, he was man like your man, لكنه كان بساما, but he used to smile a lot. He was a smiley man, meaning he was not having this look in his face. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, the last messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he used to have fun running with his wife. Sometime when we look to the West and we feel like, you know what, the West came with so many things good, we cannot deny this. And we can be proud of the level of technology and communication the West reach today. And we are a member of this society, and in my opinion, people must block this confusion, and we must recognize ourselves as well as our kids as American Muslim. It's very simple. سلمان منا أهل البيت. When the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of the Sahaba were talking about, you know, I am from Bani Hashim, and they came with this tribes issue. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked to Sayyidina Salman and he said, Salman is a member of my family. So being a member of American society does not bring any conflict with our religion. My point here is, we assume that running and having good exercise is something the West brought to us. Where the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, years back, Sayyida Aisha, she said, I used to run with him. They used to have this competition. And they said Aisha won one time, and she said, when we moved to Medina, I started gaining weight. This is her word. I am not saying anything bad about her. But this is her word. I gained weight, and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to win. He won. قالت حملت اللحم فسبقني. يعني I became heavy little bit. فالرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم سبقني. So when the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم was able to win, listen to him صلى الله عليه وسلم. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم did not stop there. He has his own sense of humor, and he looked to Sayyida Aisha and said, يا عائشة هذه بتلك. يا عائشة, remember you won years back, and I am making up for the time I lost. And she smiled, and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. So when we talk about the role model of a man being a husband in the family, learning from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very close to his family. وَيَضَعُ إِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لَيَضَعُ اللُّقْمَةَ فِي امْرَأَتِهِ لَهُ بِذَلِكَ صَدَقَةً. Put food in your wife's mouth is a way of seeking reward. Sadaqah. You gain reward by feeding your wife. Running in the morning or after work, going to any athletic club for a little bed and having your spouse with you, something Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. I understand that he did not have this, what we have now in terms of machines, but he did in the desert of Arabia. So being a member, an active member of your family, is something Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. So don't try to be a righteous man by being very strict and a scary person in the house. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do this. Well, when you talk about education, how much education do we really need? We have to learn. And the ulama, they make it very simple. Whatever mandatory within the religion, it's mandatory for us to learn. So we have to learn how to pray. We have to learn how to fast. We have to learn the tawheed, our belief. Do we have to learn how to give zakah? Not really, unless we are rich. لا يجب عليك أن تتعلم شرعا إلا ما وجب عليك صنعه. So this is why we advise our brothers, what is the role of having a business and the stock market? Is it mandatory for everyone to learn this? It is not. It's good for you to learn anyway, but it's mandatory for you if you are becoming a stock market man or woman. Then it's mandatory for you to learn the role of the stock market. Do we have to memorize the entire Quran? It's good to do so, but it's mandatory for you to memorize part of the Quran. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through his interaction with the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim, make it very simple that you have to practice what you know, whatever you know. قال من عمل بما علم, if you will practice whatever in your data, قال رزقه الله علم ما لم يعلم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide you to discover so many things you had no idea about before. So many of the Sahaba were not really deep scholars, but all of them were serious with their belief. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to spend the time teaching, learning from Jibreel first, and teaching the Sahaba and practicing what he received. Practicing. Why? Because Rasul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ لِمَا أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ لِمَا أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْ. Islam taught us to be a model for others through our action. Through our action. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that if you want to be a good Muslim, you become a member of a community. What is the Muslim community? We are a Muslim community. A Muslim community is a group of people, male and female, all of them share one identity, their belief. They do not allow culture, background, language, or country to divide them. Is this a volunteer act? Is it something good to do? No, it's mandatory. And if anyone will raise any nationalism, he is actually, or she is, doing something against the rule of the religion. It is not my word, it is actually Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam word. When the Rasul moved to Medina and they make reconciliation between Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, later on for some reasons they started initiating division again. Rasul qal, abi da'wa al-jahiliyyati wa ana bayna azhurikum. أبي دعوة الجاهلية وأنا بين أظهركم. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم considered division within the Muslim community as a behavior of الجاهلية, the period before Islam. In our religion, يا أخوانا, there is no difference, obviously, between anyone but by righteousness. إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. You might be old or young, male or female, and you can be better because of your righteousness. That's it. It's very simple, and we intend to complicate stuff. The Quran al-Karim, subhanallah, kalam rabbi al-alamin. Fasl. This is the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, well, inna akramakum inda Allahi atqaakum. The most righteous person among us can be a female, or can be a male. Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, radhiyallahu alayhi, we talk about Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he is a very big name in our history. We are talking about the 6th and 7th century in our history. When he gathered the scholars he learned from, he named so many females, and he named one of them, and they said, قال وكنت أجلس إليها وكانت تعلمني الدين, and I used to sit in front of her and she taught me my religion. الصحابة used to go to سيدة عائشة. So when we talk about the, they know when people talk about females, right, and all of this stuff, I feel like we must realize that female had the right to vote in the Middle East before they started voting in America. The female started voting in Egypt, the country I came from, before voting in America. Let us forget about America and Egypt now. The female had the right to express their opinion in the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam masjid, and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to listen to them. عارفين حديث السيدة أم هانئ؟ It was traditional that if they will have any war, or they can have any prisoner of war, أسارة or أسرة, when from the Sahaba could say, رسول الله, this person did something with me, he is under my protection. What they used to call it then, الإجارة. قد أجرت فلان. It means, يا رسول الله, this man did something with me years back, يا رسول الله, he is under my protection. And the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم will grant him the protection. The Rasul was doing this in the masjid, and the Sayyidah Umm Hani, she was one like our sisters, sitting like this exactly, and said, يا رسول الله, oh my prophet, oh messenger of Allah, قد أجرت فلان. السيدة أم هانئ, she raised her voice saying, يا رسول الله, this person is under my protection. And the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم رد عليها وقال, قد أجرنا من أجرت يا أم هانئ. يا أم هانئ, we honor your wish, we grant you the protection. So this man within the non-Muslim community becoming under the protection of a female, her name is Sayyida Umm Hani. I am not trying to look down upon the civilization in the West today. No, we learn a lot from the West. But I'm trying to say, while we are practicing our religion, please differentiate between the cultures of any of us and the rule of the religion. The rule of the religion is what Allah said and what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said according to the understand of the scholars in our history. This is our religion. We might have different culture. We might eat, some of us will eat spicy food. Some of us will do something else. This is culture. People have to do whatever they want to do in their life as long as whatever they are doing is fitting with the rule of the religion. When we talk about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we talk about someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, describing the core of his message, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we send you to be a mercy for the whole mankind. Sometime when we talk to the media, or write something in the newspaper, and they say, we wish our brothers and sisters within the non-Muslim community well, and we hope that Allah will cure anyone ill among them. Some of our people assume that we are giving what they call political statement. It is not, yakhwan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the message really we have, when you heard from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's to be a mercy for everyone. So we do indeed wish everyone well. And let me bring it to you this example. Did you hear about حلف الفضول before? Do you know what حلف الفضول? I will explain to you حلف الفضول. حلف الفضول, if you have an idea about the culture in Arabian Peninsula before Islam, it was the political system was the tribe system. So if you are a member of a big tribe, you've been protected. If you do not belong to a very good tribe, you might go through different level of difficulty. A person came outside of Arabia to have business around Mecca, around the Kaaba, and he gave Al-Asib ibn Wa'il whatever he has, goods, and he asked him to give him the money. So Al-Asib knows that he is a member of a very big tribe. So he said to him, I'm not going to give you anything. Do you know what? Do whatever you want. He knows for a fact that he is a foreigner, a person by himself, with the tribe system in Arabia, this guy will get nothing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide and protect individuals. So when this thing happened with him, he went to had his body against the Kaaba, seeking protection from God, and start calling people to get to help him to get his money back. Some people heard him. What is this? He's a guy, came with some business, and it seems like Al-As took his stuff and did not give him money back. A wise group of the people sitting, they said, we must not tolerate this. And they came with what we call today Hilf al-Fudul, a group of very wise individual. They came with an agreement that if any foreigner will come here, we will protect his right or her right until we'll get him whatever he deserves. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَدْ كَانَ بِمَكَّةَ حِلْفًا. I heard about a group of people يسمى بحلف الفضول. They call it حلف الفضول. If they will invite me to join them now, I will be honored to be a member of this group to protect the right of the individuals. Although he is talking about non-Muslim individual, he was not talking about Muslims individual. مش بس كده. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وما أحب أن يكون لي به حمر النعم. And if people will give me a choice between joining this group or giving me so much wealth, I would rather be a member of this group protecting the individuals. So when we say we have nothing in our heart but good and the care toward everyone, Muslim or non-Muslim, this is, yakhwanna, the message of Islam. This is not a political statement. This is not something for the media. This is what we have. So the Muslim community then, learning from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they all come to the masjid, male and female, and they know for a fact that they share the equal right, and some of them came from Bosnia, some of them came from Egypt, some of them came from Palestine, some of them came from Pakistan, some of them came from India, some of them actually been born and grew up in America, some of them come from Latin America. We know that we are what? Brothers and sisters. Not to be nice, it is not to have a good behavior, say, you know what, yes brother, it is, this is our religion, it's a religion, yakhwan. When we say brother, it's a part of our religion, sister, it's a part of our religion. So anyone will call to will support any division will very much doing committing a sin against the rule of the religion. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us this. So many of you fathers and mothers, and what can a father and mother we must be if we are talking about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam today? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a father. He has Sayyidah Khadija, she was a mother. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had kids, 4 girls. All of them very much passed away while he was alive, but Sayyidah Fatima, she passed away after her dad, 6 months after him. We all in America raise concern about our kids, and we often talk about the importance of our kids practicing in Islam and we are, I know that we are serious about this. But my question is, did the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca or in Medina raise the concern without acting? What did the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did? What did the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did exactly? You find the ulama al-hadith, someone like Al-Imam al-Bukhari, في الجامع الصحيح محمد بن إسماعيل, you will find him talking about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leading the salah while al-Hasan and al-Husayn climbing over their grandfather. What does it mean? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows the importance of the youth, and realize that our masajid must be busy sometime with their noise. Tarafum, when you read the Kutub al-Fiqh, the books of the jurisprudence in our religion, do you know what? Ulama al-Fiqh, they will advise the Imam Someone was leading the salah in Isha, like me or our beloved Imam here. Ulama al-Fiqh, they said, one of the conditions, allow Imam to speed in his salah to hear a child crying. They did not say it's forbidden for the child, young child to come to the masjid, but they said to the Imam, please accommodate this child concern and speed your salah. يسن التخفيف عند سماع بكاء الأطفال. So the masajid must be a welcoming place to the kids, young or old. If Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn were used to climb over Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their grandfather, and he did not say to them it's forbidden. We must learn that it's good for us to bring our kids to our masajid for them sometime to pray. Learn from the older member in the masjid, and we teach them to behave, and we try to raise them together all properly. But you know what? They have the right even to play. I mean, play without R. Play. They can do this in the masjid. It is not my opinion. I have no right to put an opinion in the religion. But this is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did in the masjid. In his masjid, in the Medina, صبيان المسلمين كانوا يجلسون. The kids within the Muslim community in the Rasul's time, they used to come to the masjid. And the kids will come to the masjid, what to do? What? They had their activity. They used to eat. And Hassan used to have recite sha'r in the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam masjid. المسجد يا اخواننا was their home. المساجد in what we call the Islamic countries had its role. Its role in the West is quite critical. This is why الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم put in front of all of us the example. Is it good to bring the kids? Yes, it's good. Even if they will climb over their daddy, they did يا اخي over الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم better than you and me. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not stop them. And he heard them crying and he welcomed them over again. I am not asking people to turn the masjid to be a wild place. But I am saying we can talk to our kids 5 minutes before we bring them to the masjid. And if you find any boy or a girl not behaving well in the masjid, please talk to him softly like he is your son or your daughter. Or if you feel like his dad or his mom a little bit sensitive, you must make a comment quietly, nicely. But while you are trying to correct him or her, please know that if we will be successful raising our kids, we will be successful having a good future for all of us. I remember we were making Umrah, since we were speaking about kids. I cannot forget this. We were making Umrah, and before we make the Umrah exactly in Mecca, it's traditional to talk to the group about we are going to make Umrah, and it's part of it to say, you know what? If you can't cry, ya akhi, for the sake of Allah around the Kaaba, do it. It's good. Allah will love you and Allah will forgive your sin. I did this. I said, try to be humble and express khushu'. And if you can cry, cry. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will clean your record. I didn't realize that one of the kids was giving me so much attention. So when we were around the Kaaba making tawaf, the child said to his grandfather, Grandfather, hit me hard. The sheikh said, we have to cry. Make me cry. It was so sweet. I cannot really forget what he did. أحسن من الكبار يعني كنا بنعمل كنا في الحج وبعدين في عرفة يعني أفضل أوقات في الحج الوقت من العصر إلى المغرب. وبقول لإخواننا ده وقت الدعاء يعني. ولقيت أخي بيدخن. قلت له يا اخي بتدخن وانت في عرفه يا اخي اتقي الله. قال يا شيخ سيبني عاوز ادعي بمزاج. اي والله we were making حج and the most important time really in حج is the time between عصر and the مغرب in the day of عرفه. So it's good to say to remind the people that this is a special time. Make دعاء. الرسول spend the entire time between عصر and the مغرب making دعاء. This is the core of the trip of Hajj. People spend 10,000 more or less for the sake of very much this 2 hours. So I find one of the brother holding cigarette, smoking. Wallahi in Arab. And he was doing something bad enough, but his response was even worse. So I said to him, "Ya akhi, don't do this in Arafah." He said, "Sheikh, leave me alone. I want to be in a good mood in the time of making dua." What is this? I'm not making this up. This is happening in the year 2005. Well, the kid, the young kid, around the Kaaba, asking his grandfather to hit him hard, to cry. It seems like was way better than his brother. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive both of them and watch over both of them. Ameen. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not allow people to come with their own interpretation of the religion. Even Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he, in the time of Salah, he was in the middle. When we talk about fasting every day, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fast Monday and Thursday. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam support by his act for people to be in the middle. Islam is a religion came with ease. Don't make it difficult. So my main point today, brothers and sisters, is to remind myself and all of my brothers here and sisters that we have to try our very best to be like Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you talk about what kind of behavior the husband must adopt in the house, well, look to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a husband. Look to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a father. Instead of Fatima used to come, and the Rasul used to stand treating his daughter very well. قال حتى كان يضع يضع لها عباءته. يعني الرسول used to take his the kind of clothes something equivalent to this, and they said سيدة فاطمة, he used to welcome her to sit in his own dress, visiting her. And الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم as a Muslim, he taught us that being worried about the Muslimin is part of our religion. Subhanallah al-Azim, I was reading what Michael Hart wrote when he wrote his famous book, Al-Uzama'u Mi'ah, the most greatest 100 individual in the history, and he started them with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was the first one. When I was going through the history of the civilization by Will Durant, I came to realize that even Will Durant, a Catholic man from California, he said, a human being must recognize Muhammad as the one of the greatest, or maybe even the greatest ever human make a change in the human being life. A person make a change in the human being life. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to be good with everyone. I will conclude with this, and I will allow you time to ask whatever you have in mind, and hopefully I have an answer for it. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we talk about making da'wah. And you know, it's good to make da'wah and call non-Muslim to Islam. And I understand this. It's part of our religion. Ta'rafu hadith al-rajul al-Yahudi. Do you know the story of the Jewish man was about to pass, to die, a young man. And the Rasul, he was a Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam neighbor. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to visit him. And this young man was about to die. It was obvious. I don't think they have internal medicine then, but they said he was about to die. And the Rasul said to him, "Kul la ilaha illallah." Say la ilaha illallah. His dad was standing. This young man looked to his dad. فنظر إليه أبوه اليهودي. His dad, the Jewish man, looked to his kid وقال له أطع أبا القاسم. Listen to to Abu al-Qasim al-Rasul kunya means listen to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, and he passed away. علماء الحديث, they intend to understand how come this Jewish man asked his own son to listen to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did with him as a neighbor? Probably he was the best neighbor ever. He convinced them through his action that he do indeed care about this family. So this father saying listen to Rasul was a result of hard work from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It reminded me with what Imam Abu Hanifa did. Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man ibn Thabit, Imam Ahl al-Kufa, awal al-Imma al-Arba'a, وإمام المذهب إمام مذهب أهل الرأي. He used to have a neighbor. Was a very, I don't know if it's a proper term to use, but he was a very wild neighbor. Each day, each night, he will drink a lot and start screaming each night. And Abu Hanifa, subhanallah al-azim, he knows that his neighbor will do this every day. Listen, every day. Abu Hanifa was a very rich man, by the way. Abu Hanifa used to give each member of his student a salary, monthly salary. If you are a good student, he will give you a salary and say, don't work, come here to learn. We are not going to give him any money. Yes. So Abu Hanifa, one day, he did not hear any noise from his neighbor. فسأل عن. Well, why our neighbor wasn't screaming last night? They said to him, well, الشرطة, the police people, took him and he is spending time in jail because he was too loud. فذهب الإمام أبو حنيفة. الإمام أبو حنيفة, he ride, whatever he used to ride, horse or whatever, and went to الأمير. فقال الأمير أدخلوه علي بدابته إكراما له. Don't let Abu Hanifa enter my area, my castle or whatever, walking. Let him walk to reach me, and let him ride until he will reach me. So فدخل الإمام أبو حنيفة. الحمد لله رب العالمين. Eventually it arrived. صلى الله رسول الله. So الإمام the governor, out of respect to Abu Hanifa, he said to the people around him, don't let Abu Hanifa walk. Have him enter my place riding his animal. Out of respect. فدخل Abu Hanifa عليه. Abu Hanifa arrived. فقال له, the governor said, يا إمام, إن لك عند ما كان لك من حاجة ما كان لك من حاجة عندنا قضيت. Whatever you came for is being taken care of. As a part of respect and showing the hospitality. Before I know what you want, please know that I will do what you want. فقال الإمام أبو حنيفة, إن جاري, my neighbor, دخل سجنك لأمر صنعه. He is in your jail because of something he did. ولقد جئت أشفع له. I came to release him. فقال له الحاكم, the governor said to him, we will free him. And anyone enter the jail in this day, out of respect for you. And Abu Hanifa did this with someone who was drunk. Drunk. This is why later on they said, he was about to sell his house. And I don't remember the exact figure, but he said, they said his house, for example, was worth 100,000, for example. And he said, I will sell my house for 1 million. They said, it's not worth 1 million. Your house worth 100,000. He said, no, my house worth 100,000, and be the neighbor of Imam Abu Hanifa worth 900,000. And the house being sold with the price he asked for. واختار وقالوا بعدها بقى ينبغي على العاقل ان يختار الجار قبل الدار. A wise person must choose the neighbor before choosing the house. This is why we ask our brothers and sisters, please, if you can afford living in a good neighborhood, live in a good neighborhood. Don't have money in the bank and allow your kids to go through rough experience. Kids sometimes speak in very rough language. If the parents can afford something better, please do so if you can. This is the act of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to practice our religion. In Islam, ya akhwanna, as-salah, as-siyam, as-zakah, and al-hajj, as well as al-iman, is 5% of the religion. That مش كلام, it is not my talk. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-iman bid'un wa sab'una, بضع وستون أو بضع وسبعون شعبة أعلاها شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأدناها إماطة الأذى عن الطريق والحياء شعبة من الإيمان. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said our religion is 70 point plus, the highest one among them all is saying لا إله إلا الله, the lowest one is taking care of the street, taking a rug away from the street. قال والحياء being shyness is part of our religion. So if our religion 70 plus point and la ilaha illallah one of them, is salah one of them. What is the entire religion, ya ikhwan? Islam haya. Is salah wa kalam da ihna bnqul alayha shaa'ir at-ta'budiyya. Is salah, is siyam, is zakah, it is not more than 5% of the religion. And you being a good student if you are learning, a good businessman if you are having a business, a good neighbor, a good father, a good son or daughter, a good wife, a good husband, this is our religion. Do you remember what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said? A man from Ahl al-Jannah, from the people of al-Jannah, will enter the masjid now. And a very humble sahabi entered, no one even recognized. And in the second day, the Rasul said the same thing, and the same man entered. And he did it the third time. Subhanallah al-Azim, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar, qala, fahtaltu li nafsi. Sayyidina Abdullah said, I came with an idea. He came with a plan. What? He went to me, oh my uncle, out of respect, the Arab used to call the older people uncle. Something happened between me and my dad, and he said to me, you are not allowed in the house for 3 days. So what? Can I spend the 3 days with you? He said, yes, you can. سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر قال فنظرت في حال الرجل. I tried to look carefully to him. الرسول said about him, he is going to Jannah. So if this guy is going to Jannah, I have to be like him. And I didn't find him fasting much or doing much salah at night. And in the third day, and they said, يا عم, oh my uncle, nothing happened between me and my dad. But الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said this, and I came to learn, and frankly speaking, he didn't find you doing much. And he said to him, wallahi ma azidu ala ma tasna ala ma ra'ayt. Wallahi, I don't do any more extra than what you saw. The only thing I guess, each time I go to sleep, I go to sleep while my heart is very clean. I don't have anything in my heart against anyone. غير أني أبيت وليس في قلبي شيء تجاه أحد. Having a pure heart is good, not good only for you in this life, but good in the hereafter. Feeling good for people and caring about them, ikhwana, can take you to Jannah. Can take you to Jannah. This is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. This is Nabilun qala fataha al-muslimuna nisfa al-dunya fi nisf qarn. Nabilun, this French general, he said, the Muslims dominate half of the world within half a century. Because of what? Because they felt good for people. And you learn that people, they practice Islam, and it was obvious while in their life. I don't want to keep you any longer. I know that the Shuyukh loves sometimes to talk a little bit. And the people had no choice but to sit. But why don't we take some questions, and hopefully we'll give you the answer.